And a very warm welcome to the medal matches of this 2015 European Team and Pairs Boccia Championships taking place here at the Surrey Sports Park in Guildford. Over the past 2 days, the top eight ranked European teams have been battling it out for an automatic place at the Rio Olympics in 2016, and it all comes down to this. I'm delighted to say once again, Jamie Doherty in the commentary box with me. This is what it all comes down to, Jamie.
Yeah, this is as big as it gets. You know, this is huge stake. A place that automatic qualification right into Rio 2016.
So the medals are all important. There's the gold and silver medals and the third and fourth playoff medal games. For the bronze medal, but it's all about that qualification for Rio, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. There's no bigger event than the Paralympics in 2016. Every team here will be wanting to be there.
So across all the courts now, how will the players be feeling?
Oh, I'd imagine there'll be a lot of nerves, and it's important about containing that nerves now and just focus on how they were playing before and the events that brought them into the final.
But they've done, say, months and weeks of preparation and hard work and training. They've been competing over the past 2 days to get to this final. It's just what it all comes down to. It's a crunch game, isn't it? Silver is great, but say Rio is the goal, and that's what they've been training for.
Yeah, as you said, Rio is the competition that everyone wants to be at. This is what they've been training for, this is what they've been working hard for, and this is only one spot available, and that's through the gold medal. Others, there is a possibility of qualifying, but that's the last thing you want to be doing, is chasing points, trying to gain up the rankings.
We were just talking about all the teams out there across the courts. Okay, there's the gold and silver medals and the bronze matches, but it's positives to be taken from everyone competing in this session now, isn't there? There's more than just medals at stake.
Yes, definitely. Second, third place can make a huge difference to your ranking, and that all goes towards being in the top eight in the world. For the teams that don't get automatic qualification, then the next highest ranked countries will then be picked.
So we've got the top eight European ranked countries here. So when the European Championships come around again, it's good to be in that top eight as automatics, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So the game we're going to be covering is the final of the BC3 pairs between Spain and Belgium. We said underdogs to be in this final.
Yeah, you know, both teams weren't as expected to get out of the groups, and it was very surprising. You know, Spain with a massive win yesterday over Portugal, and you know, Belgium, beating Great Britain and Sweden. You know, they too for me were the favourites to get through in that group. Belgium managed to pull through, and they're in the final.
So an opportunity for both teams here to really shine and just book that ticket to Rio.
Yeah.
And say we're just going through the warm-up stage at the minute. They've been in the call room again and had some warm-ups and met the referee. Perhaps you can just recap on what they do out there in the outside arena before they come into the main arena. In the call rooms, you know, so what do they do outside in the call room before they come into the main arena?
Yeah, it's just about just getting used to the floor, working on their game plan. You know, tactics might be different. They might, you know, imagine these two teams will know each other, and it's about just gaining that advantage over your opponent in this match.
I think there now becomes the hush across the arena as the referee starts all the matches together. I imagine there'll be a big roar when they all kick off, Jamie.
Yeah, the atmosphere has been absolutely fantastic over here. Over the weekend, you know, been massive support. You know, that really helps with building momentum and you know, having the support behind you, it makes a big difference.
Well, just that main entrance into the arena now, with all the lights off earlier on, with the spotlight down there, that must put the hairs on the back of your neck, make them stand up.
Oh,
it must really get the adrenaline pumping.
Yeah, definitely. You know, that gets you, you know, up for the final. This is a massive match, and there's no denying about that. They both know it, but you know, they have to be calm and focused here. both teams.
So here we go, the final. Spain versus Belgium. And it'll be Spain that will be leading us off with the BC3 pairs. It'll be four ends. Each player will have three balls respectively, and it'll be 7 minutes per end per team. And will they have done anything different between the semi-finals and the finals, Jamie? Would they have changed anything, tweaked anything, or do you stick with your original plan that's got you this far?
Yeah, I go by the saying, if it's not broke, don't fix it. You know, and I think they'll be using that, you know, positives from what they've been doing through the tournament so far and take that into the final. I don't see any need for them to change anything.
So the jack has been cast. Short jack, Jamie, a tactic that obviously a lot of teams, a lot of European teams use, and that's a decent start.
Yeah, you know, it just lets you gain control and, you know, you get that first ball on, you know, it's so important. You know, it's a little bit to the side there, which lights Belgium in. But you know, that's maybe a little bit of the nerves at the start.
It will take a couple of good deliveries just to settle those nerves, yeah, and ease them into the game. A cagey start, you anticipate?
Yeah, yeah. I anticipate that from both sides just now, because, you know, both teams know how much is at stake.
So perhaps you can just give us some background on the category of the BC3 pairs, and obviously these guys are using the ramp.
Yeah, BC3 category uses the ramps, you know, because they're not able to use their hands and be able to throw the ball. You know, this is the great thing about Boccia, is how it's, and that's a fantastic shot there, you know, straight on the jack.
Peter Killison there, world number five from Belgium. No nerves there, straight into the game, right on top of it.
And this is where Spain have to respond on their own end here and, you know, take that attack this.
Well, there's only four ends, isn't there? And I know each player has three balls, but you really can't afford a slow start in this format.
No, definitely not. You know, especially in the threes game, you know, they tend to play with harder balls than other categories, so, you know, they're easier to knock off. And you know, you don't tend to see many misses in the threes.
So Spain playing Wafid Bucharit, world number 36. We're in a number 315, playing Spain's second ball. That's an excellent ball.
Yeah, that's exactly done. They've opened that head up, you know, and allowed themselves to gain control again. And that's what's important.
Still Spain to play though. Belgium with their opening ball, still the shot. That's a good delivery. Spain just building the head up now, Jamie, just getting balls close. That might be the shot.
Yeah, I think it's lined the shot just now, but, you know, it's not. It's still giving Belgium a target here. You know, I would imagine Spain would have liked to have gone again, you know, and put one straight in there.
So Peter Killison playing again for Belgium.
Yeah, straight in front of him, you know. Yeah, you know, I couldn't see anyone else taking that shot other than him. You know, just straight in between the red and the blue and take control again for Belgium. And, you know, Spain are used, you know, quite a few number of balls already. You know, that's three they've used to Belgium's two and the threes. And that's nice. Bang on.
Two deliveries from Peter Killison and both making an impact on this opening end. And just to, you know, in the pairs format and the teams format, each player has the opportunity to play it's no set rule. You can the captain will decide with their players about who's got the best angle to attack the head.
Yeah, and that's so important in the pairs. You know, you really do not want to be leaving your pairs partner without any balls. You know, you need to keep players with balls and keep angles open, because in the pairs game, angles are so important.
Because the angles are more narrow than in a team event. And also, it's good to have really attention of the ball management, isn't it? Don't play your three balls from one player. As you say, your colleague won't have the angles required to play the shots.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen many times in the past, you know, a player been stuck with three balls and not had anything on. And, you know that can lose an end.
Spain again playing the attacking ball there, just going out of court.
Yeah, it's a very nervous start here from Spain. You know, a couple of missed shots, missed first ball. And, you know, they're trying to take it off, and a slight miss there. You know, that pressure will be building onto them here.
So Belgium still laying the one here. Francisco Fernandez, who played the jack on the opening ball for Spain. He's going to be playing again.
Yeah, it's important for Spain to really make use of these next two balls. You know, keep that head tight, you know, because that's the last thing they want to be doing, is conceding a few points in this first end.
One's not a disaster, is it? Obviously, you know, you can come back from one, but if you drop... You know, you can drop a maximum of six. You don't want a big gap to open up.
Yeah, that's exactly it, right? And especially on your ends, you know, you want to keep your own ends as tight as possible.
Yeah, we've compared it to kind of keeping your serve on tennis, isn't it? When you've got the jack, use it to your advantage, win the end.
Yeah.
But then when you can take your opponent's jack and add to it.
Yeah, and that's exactly what he's done. He's tightened that gap up between the... Putting one in between the red and the blue.
So Spain to go again. Are they just going to start blocking this up now and just concede
I'd
the
imagine,
one?
I'd imagine they'd either put one in between the two reds on the left-hand side, or give that red that's previously been played a little nudge up to secure it.
So each player will cast the jack once. It will start with Spain on the right-hand side and alternate between the Belgium and Spain players. In the event of a tied game, there will be an extra end. The extra end, Jamie, in a situation like this between a gold and a silver, must be a very intense pressurized situation. Have you ever been involved in such a position? Or
personally, no, I've not. I've been lucky that I've not been in that much of a pressure situation. But you know, it's important again. You know, keeping your nerve. You know, I've seen some tie breaks in a final that's, you know, just been very nervy, and not any players have been capitalizing on any shots.
Despite all the training and the preparation and the meticulous attention to detail, you can't train for these kind of games, can you?
No, definitely
not. It's about handling the pressure on the day, isn't it? It's about playing your A game that's inside you, and you just need to pull out your best performance.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's about, you know, that this is where you get to see how strong mindset is here, and how mentally strong. And it's at the end of this match, the winner will be whoever's mentally best prepared for this.
And although the team from Belgium or Spain will qualify, it's not necessarily the players that will go to Rio, is it? So there's a lot to play for between selection for Rio and today.
Just because, you know, you're on the court right now and you've won a gold doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be the one going. You know, that could be booked for someone else to come and play in that place if they're playing well enough to take your spot.
So Belgium still holding the shot.
Yeah, they look to really try and open this up and get a few more points, you know. an extra one or two in this first end will be massive. It'll give them more confidence going into to their next end.
Just a slight delay here. I think that's Belgium going to play. So Spain have played all their deliveries now, all their balls. Is there an opportunity for Belgium to capitalise here and add to this? Or
yeah, I think Belgium will be looking to get maybe another point or two out of this. You know, I'll give them a real good boost going into their end next.
They put the extension on the ramp. What does that suggest? That they're going to play firm shot because it's a short jack?
Yeah, as soon as an extension comes on for a short jack, that means that they're going in for power. Now they're looking to open up the head. And he slightly moves that red.
Has that made it any better for Belgium at all?
Perhaps he's gave himself a line in to completely take that red out now. He's kind of split the two reds up, you know, because the thing is when two balls are stuck together, they're very hard to move. But if you separate them and then you then concentrate on single hitting a single target, it makes it a lot easier to open up a head.
From the outset, you can see Spain were quite aggressive with their tactics, weren't they? That we've discussed on many occasions the various types of balls and equipment used. You know, the softer balls with the rocks, the harder balls. You know, if you've got three balls each here, what would you arm yourself with? What would each player have in their armory for this final?
You know, it varies on the player. I would go in with you know, some of my softer balls for my first ball. You know, I think it's imperative that each player has that really hard ball just to move things and open things up.
You'd have a minimum of one hard ball each player just to give yourself a chance to open things up.
Yeah. And it looks like the ramp's pointing down his side, so what he's actually doing here is preparing for his ends.
Okay.
They're going to be taking the point, it looks like, right here. And
so these are going to be practice balls for future ends. So Belgium will have the jack on the second end. You anticipate that the jack will be cast to the left-hand side of the court as we see it. And these are practice balls, yeah?
Yeah. It's a very smart move. You know, Belgium obviously see not really many ways of getting in. And they don't want to risk, you know, it's a good first point for Belgium. You know, they can build on from this, and it puts the pressure on Spain, and it's going into their end next. And, you know, this gives them some practice on his first ball.
So instead of trying to take advantage of the head and add to it and possibly cause some damage, they're using it wisely now to see how the court reacts to the short jack.
Yeah.
And practice ball, so they've got more an advantage than Spain will have when this kind of length is played.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Yeah, so it's a very smart tactic indeed.
So it looks like the one will be scored by Belgium on this first end.
I would have personally liked to have seen Belgium attack this a little bit more, because I think they did have room to play in there. You know, especially, you know, the harder balls being in there, they would have moved.
So also in the BC3 category, each player will have an assistant as well. Perhaps
yes.
You can just tell us, you know, the role and the responsibility of the assistant they play in this game.
You know, the threes are there with the ramp, their players, the ramp assistants are there with the players all the time. They do as much training as they do. And, you know, they really are the, you know, the movers of the ramp. You know, it's such a hard job. You know, they're not allowed to see the game, and they're following directions from the players, which will be the opposite. So, you know, and it's really nice to see now in the BC3 in the rule change of Boccia that they now get a medal as well. And
so it's a two-man team, essentially. The assistant gets a medal as well with the outcome, because they put all the training in.
Yeah, they put in as much work as the players do.
As you say, they have to face the BC3 player. They're not allowed to communicate, they can only take direction. Must be quite hard to do that. It must be although all the training's gone on, you know, you want to try and help your colleague, don't you? You want to try and get the best results. So it must be quite hard to say nothing.
And you'd be curious as well, you know, what's going on behind you, you know. You're only really judging by reactions on players' faces. You never fully get to see what's going on, and then the only time they get to see is when they're allowed to pick up the balls at the end of an end.
So, but it was one to Belgium. So they take a 1-0 early lead into this match, already 15 minutes into it. The Belgium will be taking the jack on the second end, and each team has their own jack. I still find it really fascinating, is that that's a tactical advantage, isn't it? The softness of the jack and the jack you've been training with, you can take it with it, you? So you can bring the training environment to the match.
Yeah, definitely, and that gives you know, each pairing a huge advantage. You know, this is a jack both of these players will be happy with. They've been playing for the last couple of months, perhaps years with.
And comfortable in casting it, because that jack is pretty much spot on where the practice balls went for Belgium. So the jack casting is just as important as playing the balls, isn't it?
Yes, definitely, you know. And as we saw earlier, he casted his two blue balls aside to that left-hand side and used that time to really practice on that.
So you can see the court outlined in yellow. The jack has to pass that yellow mark, doesn't it, on the V. That's the boundary of the jack. But I'm right in saying that the balls don't necessarily have to pass that yellow line.
No, the balls can stay, as long as the white ball is over that V line, then your first ball could actually be before it. Where it differs is at the sidelines. A ball's on the sideline, even touching it, then that's deemed as out.
So a good start from Belgium.
Spain will be looking to capitalise on this.
Well, they were forced Spain to play quite negatively in that first end, wasn't they? Obviously, don't want to be pushed back into a corner at each end. So
they had a couple of attempts to attack that, but they realised, you know, they're better just blocking in, conceding the 1 point, you know, rather than conceding 2-3. And it was a wise decision in the end, and it's given them a chance through this match.
That's a great start from Spain there.
Yeah, just using that blue, it's went to the side there well, you know, allowing themselves that bigger target and making it easier for themselves.
So Belgium to now go, Spain holding the shot. Looks as though Peter Kielsen is going to play this one for Belgium.
Yeah, I'd imagine they'd play quite an attacking shot here, yeah, to move the red or move the jack ball. Yeah, the extension's coming on.
Well, the extension seems to say there's going to be a positive ball coming here, and is this when you would play your rock?
This is when you might play your rock. You know,
so this is the firm ball that is designed to open the head up.
Yeah, you see, especially in the threes game, they'll have more than one rock normally, and it's
played
taking
it perfectly.
White straight back. Yeah, that's a fantastic shot. Gives Belgium control of the game again and puts the pressure on Spain.
Superb effort from the world number five there, but it's Spain now in control of the end. They're next to play. The big skill is when you don't need to use your rock ball, isn't it? And judging how far the softer ball against the harder ball rolls across the surface is quite a detailed skill to have, isn't it? Because obviously they will roll further distances.
Yeah, you'll see most teams what the BCT is called calibrating. You know, that they'll have certain points on the ramps where they know where to release each ball, and that's just through, you know, so much preparation and getting used to the balls, the flooring, and various other things.
So it's going to be Francisco Fernandez for Spain, also putting the extension on. No, I don't think it is, actually. I think it's Wafid Boucherit.
Yeah, I imagine he'd be looking on to knock on the red ball there to the side.
He's played the blue ball.
He's taken the blue away, but that's opened it up for himself now. I think either of those shots would have been okay. Either knocking on the red. If he knocked on the red, Spain would have been in control earlier, but they might not necessarily be in a better position. Now they've got a clear jack open.
Oh, each side's had two balls each. In each discipline, each team will have six balls, so two each in a team event, three each in a pair, and in the singles you'll have all six yourself. I'm guessing each player will have a set of red balls and blue balls, and they will be identical or as close as.
Some players actually have different balls and different colours. I have different blue balls and different red balls.
And what's the reasoning behind that?
Just for some tactical plans, you know, if I want to change things up, you know, because if I'm blue, I'll have the last end. You know, I maybe want to change up my lengths, so I've got a couple of balls that it do the job longer.
So it gives you a bit of variety and variation in your game rather than having the same set identical to each other.
Yeah, I think it's so important just to have variety in this game. Just be that little bit different.
But there's so many different permutations, isn't there? There's so many different outcomes that can possibly happen. You need to give yourself the best opportunity.
Yeah.
You don't want to be targeted for one specific area, because if that doesn't...
Yeah, that doesn't work.
Doesn't happen, then you're pretty snookered.
Yeah, that's right. You know, it's about being open to playing all across the court and really, really working on all areas. I think it'll be interesting, ends 3 and 4, you know, if Spain don't get in control, you know, I'd imagine they would change up the tactics, because both teams have played pretty short right now.
It's a little scrappy from Spain at the minute.
Yeah, it's
a little bit inconsistent.
Yeah, definitely is indeed.
So the individual world rankings for each player: Wafid Boucherit is 36, and Francisco Fernandez is 45 for Spain. On paper, Belgium looked the stronger with Peter Killison, world number 5, and Kenneth Verwimp, world number 20. So you'd say, on paper, Belgium probably the favourites. But this is, you know, it's a European final.
Yeah, that means that all goes out the window in a final.
And there you go, there's
and
a massive ball.
Back in control again. And this is where Belgium have to respond. For Belgium, again, have that advantage of balls. No, Spain perhaps took too many balls to get in control there.
I think they've had 4 now, Spain.
Yeah.
Against the Belgium 2.
And that at the end can cost you an end, you know, using too many balls to get in control.
Kenneth Verwimp. Playing this ball, getting the extension on the ramp. And these are the ramps. Fiberglass, custom made, a really bespoke piece of kit that is essential for the BC3 players.
Yeah, definitely. They want to protect these ramps as much as possible when they're traveling. You know, they're in protective cases. You know, they really are quite fragile.
That's an excellent ball there from Belgium. I think that has opened it up to hold.
Yeah, and that's
one
just
to the blues,
putting the pressure on Spain again, and that's exactly what they keep doing.
Every question that's being asked is being answered by Belgium at the minute.
Yeah, you know, Spain are just taking too many balls, perhaps, just to get in control, and that looks to be costing them this end.
I guess the ideal thing when you're travelling around is to take these ramps on as hand luggage to make sure they don't get damaged, but I guess they're too big and too heavy to do that.
Yeah, unfortunately, they're just a tad too big, you know, and it's just about making sure that they're well protected as possible, you know, because that's the last thing you want to be turning up in a competition in your ramps.
Well, I imagine it's like a snooker player with their cue and darts with their darts, you know, darts players with their darts. You know, you've got used to this ramp. You know what it does. You know the feel of it. You know the everything about it in an intimate way. But if you were given another ramp for any reason, whether it was damaged or stolen or whatever, it's starting again.
Yeah, it's exactly that. You know, it's a bit more dramatic than if you a snooker player lost his cue or his, because that has all the markings on the ramp, you know, each
it's
position.
It's taken months and
it's taken
years to perfect.
Years, yeah.
Francisco Fernandez to play for Spain. Again, the extension being placed on the ramp. Right up to the top. And what holds the ball at the top? Is it Velcro that holds it in place for the player?
Yeah, it's usually players tend to use Velcro just to keep, but some players actually use a sponge.
Oh, he's played it again. This is tit for tat at the moment from both teams.
Yeah.
Spain now holding.
Belgium again got that advantage of balls, you know. Three balls left to Spain's one now. Belgium, I imagine, would be looking just to sit on in between the red and the white and cause Spain a...
It's still a good angle for both Belgian players, though.
Yeah. I think looks like Peters would be coming in between there as he's got the better angle to come in.
But even though Belgium have got three balls to play, it's key that they count. There's no point in having the ammunition if you don't do anything with it.
Yeah, that's right. Especially on their end, they'll be looking to capitalise on and getting as much out of their own end.
I guess like any sport, this is a game of opinions and decisions on when to play the right shot and what is the right shot and who should play it and which ball should be used. All these different decisions can win or lose your games, and the best decision makers are at the top of this game.
Yeah, definitely. I would say, you know, your top guys in the world are the ones that can make those decisions and under pressure and being timed, you know.
Have a clear mind under pressure in intense situations where they can make a clear, concise tactical decision without being flustered in any way.
Yeah, that's so important, being in a pair as well, with that having that effective communication between both, and you know, really making sure that the right player's playing the right shot at the right time.
So Belgium back in control. Spain with only one ball left, so bit of an uphill task here for Spain.
Yeah. They're looking just, put one straight on the blue. They're looking just to secure that. Although it is quite open for Belgium here.
Belgium opportunity to score another one at least.
Yeah, I can see Belgium taking another 1 point.
Yeah. And you can see some of the balls there with the number two on it. Just explain the reasoning behind why each ball's numbered.
Yeah, each ball's numbered because that, you know, they'll be numbered from one to six, and one may be a player's softest ball and six be the hardest ball, and that's just so they get that consistency of knowing what ball's used for what shot.
And the level of detail is that I've been told, and as a newcomer to this ball, is that even the seams have an influence about how the ball rolls over the court, and the balls have arrows on so they know which way they should be positioned on the ramp.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I've seen
hand.
So many balls come off the end of a ramp and just roll off because it's, you know,
because they're not perfectly round, are they? That they're soft and they're not perfectly round.
Yeah, it's important. You mostly see most ramp assistants rolling the balls before they put them in just to make sure they're as round as possible.
So Spain out of balls now. They are one down on the match as well. An opportunity to put some daylight between Belgium and Spain. Only four ends, so Spain got to get on the front foot rather than playing negatively all again. You know, the second end in the row here where they've just put a ball close to try and stop Belgium scoring any more, which isn't... They're going to lose 4-0 plus if they carry on at this rate.
Yeah, that's right. I think they need to maybe change up their tactics a little bit, go a bit longer. you know, the shot area is not really working for them.
Oh, that could be possibly scoring there, two.
Yeah, it looks like two for Belgium, you know, and that's exactly what they'd been looking for.
Minimum of two there. I mean, it's difficult to tell the angles. Could be more.
Yeah, it could be.
And so when you get to this stage now, gold and silver medal, all the hard work you've done to get here, you want to play your A game, don't you? You want to, if you're going to be beaten by a better team rather than a lackluster performance.
Yeah, that's right. You know, you want to dig in deep here. If I was Spain, you know, I'd want to be coming out strong in my third end, you know, taking them that little bit further and putting them under pressure. Because so far, you know, they've let Belgium in and they've been, like you says, on the back foot the whole game.
So I think the end potentially is over. I think either all balls have been played or Belgium have decided not to play their last one. The referee measuring. So you think with Spain having the jack on the third end, this is going to be a change of approach to this second half of the game?
Yeah, I would imagine Spain will come out and play that a little bit longer. They really have to try and shake something up, as you know that.
Most of the European teams though tend to play short though, don't they? They're reluctant to play long.
Yeah,
because
that's
obviously
a very European
skill.
Style to play short.
So is it a case of Spain that's thinking, right, we'll just go long and we'll scrap it out just to try and see if we're slightly better than the Belgians here and get on the scoreboard and get back in this game?
Yeah, and you know, every team is, you know, so comfortable in that shot position. But right now the shot position is not working for Spain. You know, they've lost two ends now in that shot position, and I think they need to shake things up. You know, it'd be interesting if Spain and there's 4 points for Belgium.
It was
there.
Close to two. It was definitely a two. So Belgium with a commanding lead now. It looked close
really,
for the third and fourth
really
shot there.
Spain will look to change things up. I think Spain could call a timeout here. You know, just to kind of stop Belgium's momentum here. Because, you know, it's Belgium, you know, have control of this game now.
It's a runaway train at the minute. We're halfway through this this final in the BC3 pairs. And it's been one-way traffic so far. Spain not even given a sniff of getting into it. But they say they've been forced to play negative by Belgium. It's just...
Yeah, you know, and that's just about the shot execution. Taking too many balls to get
it's kind of two for one, isn't it? Spain are taking two shots to get control of the head, yeah, where Belgium are just doing it in one go.
Yeah, that's exactly right, you know, and that's taking too many balls to get in that position where you're putting your team under pressure, you know. And Belgium had the balls at the end to do something with, and they managed to get four balls out of it.
So Spain have called a timeout. How is this timeout used? I think it, you know, from a perspective here, it's used in many different ways, isn't it?
Yeah, normally you'll see teams use it as a way to stop the other team's momentum from building, you know, and to really get the players in, coaches, you know, emphasising, refocusing them, you know, discussing tactics, discussing maybe a different place to play in.
So sometimes it's used for the team that's called the timeout to have a chat about how things have gone, but also mainly or particularly just to stop the opposition and stop their flow.
Yeah, I think that's so important because this match has all been Belgium so far.
So just to stop that momentum from Belgium, just break up their rhythm and just call a timeout, take 2 minutes to have a chat, regroup, start the match again. Whatever's gone in the past, the coach will come on, have a chat. Yeah. Whatever's gone in the past is gone now.
It's so important that they remain positive now going into this their own third end here. You know, I'd imagine they'll change up their tactics a little bit here. Because they really need to do something here in the third end. They really try and gain a foothold back
into
this match.
It's a must-score end for Spain, isn't it? It's a minimum of one. Just to even say, you still need to score, you know, four on that last end, which is a big ask. It's probably got to be at least a minimum of two for Spain.
Yeah. Yeah, for Spain to have any chance.
And they've made a substitution, Spain.
Yeah, and, you know, again, they must be looking to change things up. You know, you bring on this player.
They brought on him out. Zhu Zhao. Hope I've pronounced that right. But it's always difficult for a sub to come on. I mean, coming in a medal match, halfway through a final, when you're 5-0 down, what's the expectation here for Amal?
I think it's just to really try and, you know, shake things up a little bit here and you know, be a bit different, you know. I think it is, like you said, very hard for the substitute to come on and, you know, gain a grip hold of the match, you know, especially when they're down in momentum already, you know, and, you know, this will be interesting to see how this pans out.
So as well as the tie break, we've had a substitution where he's obviously added a bit more time onto the break, which is, you know, could affect Belgium that little bit more.
Yeah, that's right. You know, that just stops him a little bit, you know, when they're on that high momentum, you know.
Well, I'm out here for Spain, number 3-2-3. Just having last pieces put into place. This could be an opportunity for her, isn't it, to come in and really make an impact, to say.
Yeah.
Probably an opportunity that she didn't expect.
Yeah.
Two ends to really come on and make a difference.
Yeah, this is her time to really show.
A place at Rio at stake, this could be the chance to shine.
Yeah, that's right, you know. Obviously, you know, she'd be disappointed to be on the bench, you know, and this is her chance to come on and show, you know, what she can do. Because Spain really do need something different here, and you know, she could be the way forward for Spain.
So Francisco Fernandez has gone off for Spain. He'll obviously be disappointed being taken off during such a critical match.
Yeah.
But this is a tough job for a coach, isn't it? You know, to make these key decisions about who to play, who not to play.
Yeah, that's right. You know, the coach felt that, you know, the player just was missing maybe perhaps too many shots. No, not. And they went short again. You know, I'm actually quite surprised at that. You know, I thought that they've changed things up a little bit.
Well, it's not been paying off so far, but maybe the substitution coming on, you know, that may be her strength.
Yeah, maybe.
The ball's over that side of the court.
It's important Spain have a really good first ball here and take control of this end.
That's the thing, that's been the problem. They've not taken control, have they? They've left too many gaps and not responded quick enough when asked the question by Belgium. So Wafid Bucharit has played one of the near enough perfect opening ball.
Yeah, that's exactly what Spain needed, because that forced Belgium to now attack that and try and open it up for themselves here.
Attacking's great as long as you hit the target, isn't it?
Yeah.
Missing, ball wasted.
Yeah, you know, and that's the last thing, especially in a final, you want to be doing is having wasted balls.
So Peter Killerson going to play the opening delivery for Belgium. Be looking to open this up straight away. So the harder ball.
This might be a case of not using your hardest ball because the angle's not fully on the jack. And that's
perfect.
An absolute fantastic shot to move that ball and sit in there, you know, to have that control. That's a fantastic shot.
Straight away, a turnaround and a reaction from Belgium.
And like he says, you know, Belgium have been doing shots that Spain have been doing in two, and Belgium have been coming back and doing it in that one ball.
If Belgium score two here, is that match over? Does the final end get played, or is it just because it's straight knockout now?
Yeah,
the match is over.
The final end will still be played.
It will still be played regardless.
Yeah, but it'd be very disappointing for Spain, you know.
It feels a bit cruel, doesn't it, to play an end that you know you can't win the gold medal when
the
match is all but over. What's the reasoning behind that? I mean, in the pool games, I understand that, you know, on a league basis, you have to see the match out because points difference will come into play. In a knockout, is there any particular reason why the game is played in full?
No, there's not really any particular reason, you know. I think it's just sportsmanship to carry on at the end of the game, you know, but it's not a nice thing at all, you know.
It must be a horrible situation to be in, especially yeah. in such an important match.
Yeah, definitely, you know. Spins, you know.
So Spain going straight through this. Amal Zujao chucks straight into the action. Opened it up slightly, but probably it's close. Referee's going to measure this.
Yeah, just she never caught with that fully there. Just a kind of brush with the ball, and it took it back, you know.
Referee indicating, I think Spain are holding, so it'll be Belgium to play. I guess same ball from Peter Killerson again. He's got the angle.
I would fancy that, you know, the other Belgian player coming in from his angle and shoving the blue in. You know, because that keeps the ball count at two each.
Well, I think it's...
And it's... Looks like it's... Might
Belgium.
Be
It is Spain to play again, sorry, so Belgium will be holding. We didn't see the referee hold his paddle up. But it's a good ball there from Spain.
Yeah, that's important for...
They seem to have a little bit more control over this.
Yeah, you know, it's, you know, about Spain now using that ball and taking control again.
So it's probably Spain to play again.
Yeah.
But here they can put a ball in to really start to dominate this third end.
Yeah, they need to, you know, Spain again will be disappointed that they've, you know, how many balls they've used again. You know, this is Spain's fourth ball and Belgium have only used one right now.
But the good news is for Spain is that Amal's come on. This is her third delivery, but she's had an impact on this straight away.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, no, she's not missed a shot yet. Perhaps the shot's not been 100%.
But not been far away either.
No.
And played it perfectly now.
Yeah. And that's now Spain in control here. And that's now time for Belgium to respond.
But as you say, four balls down for Spain. Not ideal, but they've got a better position here. But Belgium are more than capable of turning his head over.
Yeah. Definitely, you know, we saw that earlier before, you know, Belgium, and even that second end, you know, I thought that two or three would have been good, and managed to get four in there. You know, Belgium, you know, opening up heads have been pretty good.
So just a question regarding ramps again. The ramps are allowed to go in the opponent's part of the court, but they're not allowed to touch the ground.
Yeah, just as long as they're not allowed to touch the ground, there'll be the linesmen at the back there making sure that... that ramp doesn't touch.
And does that have an impact? Because there is obviously a gap between the court and the ramp. Does that have an impact on the delivery of the ball? Because obviously it's going to jump slightly.
Yeah, it gives it also gives you that advantage of angles as well. You know, because they're not throwing the ball, they don't have maybe as much you know, angle wise. From the box, so to be able to go into your opponent's box helps.
Well, it's a good delivery from Kenneth Verwimp there, world number 20. The referee going to have to measure this with the feeler gauges because the gap is so tight.
Yeah, again, that's just Belgium putting up the pressure back on Spain again, making them play.
And they're making a change, aren't they, Belgium, with every ball at the minute. That's their strength. That's why they're just... command in the game in the minute. An improvement for Spain, but obviously there needs to be a little bit more, doesn't there?
Yeah, you know, Belgium look very, very
so Belgium to play again.
That short area.
The referee there holding up a paddle, blue one side and red the other, which indicates which team is to play next.
you know, it'll be interesting, you know, if there's another shot for Kenneth to actually completely take that red out, because Spain have played out on that very wide position. Now that red being taken out will cause Spain quite a lot of
the
problems.
Angle for Spain is not great, is it, from their other player?
No,
Wafid Boucherid. So if they take the red away, there's no angle there to really play with, the blues sitting in front, and it's a free rein for Belgium to play in.
Yeah, and then again, Spain are now in the position that they have to attack, you know, 5-0 down. They have to attack this end, no matter what.
It's a must-win end, really. Even, that's a terrific ball from
And Spain are
Belgium.
Now in a lot of trouble now.
I mean, this game is, you know, if Belgium score one here, 6-0, the chance of a full house on the last end, you would say not. I'm not sure if there has been a full house this weekend. I've seen a 5, but I've not seen a 6. Very difficult. So Belgium back in control. And that was a great, great delivery from Kenneth Vilhelm there.
Yeah. You know, Spain have been asked a lot of questions here right now.
They've just not been allowed to play, have they? Every time they've got something close like that one there.
Yeah, Belgium have just taken control immediately. And that has been the difference in this final.
So a lot of pressure on the Spaniard. Got to deliver here. He's got 2 balls left. Belgium still with at least one to come. What are the options here for Spain? I mean, it's looking... That's a little bit unlucky, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, it's very unlucky to that ball not to sit up on top
of it. It sat on top of it and it rolled off and rolled away from the jag, didn't it?
That's just because, you know, the threes play with it, they're a little bit harder balls, you know, that can tend to happen.
And you can see they're harder, can't you, by the seams. They look to be filled that little bit more, don't they, the harder balls. So last ball for Spain, this to really keep them in this final. Otherwise, it looks as though it'd be a silver medal for Spain. And it's been pretty comfortable for Belgium so far. The extension being put on again. What are the options here? I mean, he's opened it up slightly. Can he play the Belgium ball away?
Yeah, I think he'd be looking to, you know, going a little bit positive here and move things back.
Looking for the blue ball. He's played it. I think he's done enough for at least one. It's a fantastic delivery there.
They're in control, but Belgium, you know, have, you know, so many balls left now.
This is the problem, isn't it? One really isn't good enough for Spain. It will keep them in this match, but Belgium have still got a couple of deliveries to come.
Yeah, they have 3 balls left.
3 balls left, and you would fancy that they can take that red ball out, or they just need one, really, just to secure the victory.
They just need one. I'd imagine they're just
minimum 1-2 for a confirmed victory.
Yeah, you know, he can actually afford to come with a little bit of weight here and move the, you know, the ideal shot for Peter would be to come in with a little bit of pace on the white, move it back, and he could actually get 2 from the blue it's to the left.
So it's Peter Killerson to play the ball, I think, or is it Kenneth Vilhelm? I'm not sure who's lining up here. I think it might be Kenneth.
Yeah, it's Kenneth. I was quite surprised.
Well, this to really guarantee the gold medal for Belgium in this BC3 pairs final. And I think that's enough. Or is it? Very close.
You know, this is no... Peter has the choice of actually, if you can see that blue coming in there again, you know, nudge the red back a little bit. You know, he's also got an open target with the jack as well.
He's that much closer, he's got a better angle. You would really favour him to do something with this.
Yeah, especially with 2 balls left, you know, from where he is. You know, it's You know, to expect Belgium to get, you know, the point out this end. You know, it's relatively open.
So here we go. Peter Killison, world number 5, has just secured nigh on the gold medal for Belgium.
Yeah, you know, there's no way back for Spain now. You know, and they have to play this last end now. You know, and it will not be a...
Will they look for two?
Yeah.
Or will they be happy with the one? I mean, 6-0 up with one to play. You know, it's all looking rosy in the Belgium garden at the minute.
Yeah. This is about Belgium being ruthless here and really getting that message across to all the next opponents that they are playing well at the minute.
Looking for two, and it may well be there. That is just sheer class from Peter Killison. Really turning the knife in Spain here. It must be painful from the Spanish perspective, but you know, 5-0 up and
right
holding
now,
two.
Spain will be wanting to get straight off that court, but they have another end to play. And, you know, there's nothing worse than, you know, being out of a match before the game's actually even finished.
Yeah, it must be heartbreak for Spain, but they have got the consolation of the silver medal, as you say, and it's good ranking points for coming second in this classification. Good positive things to take potentially to Rio next year.
Yeah, you know, imagine Spain, you know, now probably still have to have the battle of trying to get more points at the next competitions. You know,
but for Belgium, automatic qualification, and this pairing of Kenneth Verwimp and Peter Killison have shown real intent today. I mean, really going for it there. The last delivery, one's good enough, but they've really gone for the kill there, haven't they?
And yeah, you know, that's
got the match summed up.
Absolutely fantastic from Belgium. You know, you cannot fault the performance today.
And you can see why Peter Killison has got that big smile on his face. He knows that Belgium have secured the gold medal. And all the hard work, preparation, training, and the 2 days of competition have paid off. There's the indication for two from the referee. So 7-0.
Yeah, Belgium have been absolute world class yesterday, you know.
Yeah. And as you say, Belgium are probably someone that are underdogs coming through this classification. Yeah. The favourites like Great Britain didn't make it through. So Belgium, are they someone now to be feared? I mean, they've got a combination here that seems very well to work for them.
Yeah, they'll certainly be ones that every team will be looking out for now, you know, and to win this final and the style that they have as well.
Just very professional and clinical. They're even going to make a substitution.
Yeah, you know, Belgium.
Belgium, which they can do, they can use this end as they wish.
Yeah, Belgium, you know, using that substitution to give, you know, another player some experience coming on to a final, you know, and showing what they're capable of doing.
So it'll be Judy Lamberich to come on for this final end with her assistant. As you say, you live and die as a team, don't you? You win and lose as a team.
Yeah. You know.
So a great time. No pressure on Judy here to come and enjoy this moment.
Yeah, you know, she can come on the court and enjoy this moment and really live in the moment.
No pressure whatsoever. She's got to cast a jack. She's coming into the fourth box. She will be casting a jack for Belgium. So would they change something here? Would they just come chuck something random in here knowing that it doesn't really matter?
You know, it would be interesting to see what Belgium do here because they could, you know, use this end as an end to, you know, try out some other things as it's been secured.
Or is there a case, as you say, send a statement out there, send a message out there, play to your tactics that you've been sticking to all weekend, and go for another 3 or 4 here and
really send
go
that
to
message
town.
To each opponent.
Well, we'll soon see. Thank you. So Julie Lamberich of Belgium, you can see the arrow there pointing down, casting the jack. They've gone short again. They're sticking to their game plan.
Yeah, looking to send out a message here to the, to everyone. This is a great chance for Julie to now show what she's capable of. Because right now it looks like Peter and Kenneth are the favoured pair. You know, this is
European champions, gold medal. You can't do any more than that. But as you say, it's only the place for the country, this book, not the players.
Yeah.
There's still a long way to go.
And this is a good time for Julie to show what she's capable of in the final.
When do the teams for the Olympic game or Paralympics get announced for the competition? How much notice do you get?
It varies from each nation because of you know, because you're coming under the Paralympic team instead of your governing body of just that of your sport. So it's really that wider perspective of you know, a bigger organisation bringing all athletes from a whole multitude of sports together as a team.
It must be a relief when you get the nod to go.
Yeah, you know, everyone's been training for so long.
It's only a year now till the actual Olympics and Paralympic Games.
Yeah.
In Rio, so the time will soon pass quickly.
Yeah, that you definitely want to be booking your tickets there, you know, because I think it'll be a fantastic.
And I would imagine that the opportunity to showcase yourself is quite small, because you know you probably get about, I don't know, say on average 3 to 6 months before you go to, so you can train properly. So end of the year, you've got to show your stuff.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and this is, you know, the time, like you said, to show what you can do.
So the match has been going on for 57 minutes at the minute. Spain in control. I guess they'll just be looking for a consolation here. Get on the board, yeah. Try and make the score respectable.
Yeah, Spain will just look to just get some points on the board here. And, you know, again, Spain are not under any pressure because they've lost this match. And they, again, they'll be looking just to
end on a high. Try and end the match on a high. And as you say, Belgium will be, on the other hand, trying to end the game with intent and a message sent out to the opposition around the arena. The ramp coming out. That's a good response from Belgium.
Yeah, that's allowed no Belgium into the head now, just slightly moving that red round on the angle. And imagine it'd be Julie to put one in here and give Belgium back that control again.
Good angles all round here for Belgium, isn't it? They're still to play, Spain holding the shot.
Yeah. You know, Spain would have been disappointed not being able to do that from earlier on, you know. Just taking too many balls to get in control. And that's ultimately at the end cost Spain this game.
Well, as you can probably tell, there is a Great Britain game going on in the arena as well. There's plenty of noise around here. Really good atmosphere throughout the weekend.
Yeah, it's been, you know, a fantastic sports centre as well. It's been held at as well, you know. And the support from Boccia is usually really good. And that helps the teams.
Well, that's good again from Belgium. Close for the shot. Again, referee just going to measure. Just about get the calipers in there. Yeah. think it's Belgium to play again, but they've played three balls, Jamie, but it's a nice tight head, isn't it? I mean, they know the job's done.
Yeah. You know, they could just play into that now and just...
No fear.
Yeah. You know, there's no pressure at all. Belgium here, you know, this is just demonstrating what they can do and sending a message across to all their opponents.
So, fourth ball from Belgium. Probably only needs just a touch, doesn't it, just to get the shot.
Yeah, it doesn't need too much to get in control.
Oh, he's planted the red ball out perfect.
Fantastic shot, that.
Well, that is pinpoint precision. Out of all the four balls there, he's managed to pick out the Spain ball. That must be complete and utter heartbreak for Spain. Just when they think they might get on the board, they could be two, maybe more down. So Spain to play. You've got four blue balls forming a wall in front of the jack. What can you do?
Yeah, you have to. If you were Spain, you have to attack this. You know, they would be wanting, as you said, to go out this match in a high. You know, they have nothing to lose now.
It's a big target, though, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. You know, coming in between the two blues and trying to split things open here. You know, going with real positive shot here, you know, and really attack this and open things up for them.
So it's going to be Amal Zajal.
Yeah, I'm a little bit surprised the other player's not playing.
Well, he's got further to go, this one, hasn't it? So.
Yeah, just in terms of angles, I'd have preferred the nearer player going in between the two blues.
Well, it's a little unlucky there. Made a connection, but the ball's rolled over the top and out the head. Still looks like two to Belgium.
It slightly gave another player an angle to come in between, you know, if he chooses to play that
shot. There's a gap now, isn't there, to play with. Still Spain to play. Wafid Boucheret, world number 36. Slightly better angle, slightly closer. You need accuracy to play this shot.
Yeah, it's still not an easy shot. You know, he has to go in with the right pace as well.
You can see the arrow on that ball pointing down. He's played it spot on.
Perfect. You know, that's just too late from Spain, though. You know.
Those were the balls they had to play earlier in the game, weren't they? When they had that chance, that like that one, they didn't take that.
Yeah, and that's...
It would take another go to fill that gap.
You know, it took Spain too many balls in the previous ends, and this end have demonstrated that they have the capability of pulling out these shots.
Well, there'll be no panic from Belgium here. What's the obvious shot for Belgium? I mean...
You know, Belgium can just slightly nudge up their blues. You know, get in control again. You know, he's got a good target to aim for here.
Well, it looks as though Belgium are just happy to settle for the one down here.
Yeah. No, Belgium have nothing really to lose. I would have liked them to maybe attack this a little bit more. And sure.
They're just packing the head out now, aren't they? It's just...
Yeah.
He's already played this.
Yeah, that head's looks pretty tight. You know, Spain will, you know, maybe want to attack this now. And
well, they've got a lot of balls to hit, haven't they? A lot of impact to make if they play direct to it.
Yeah, this is about Spain showing what they can do here. You know, they'll be wanting to rectify the previous end from this end. You know, look, okay, they've not won the gold medal, but it's about, you know, going out this game with a bang here.
Personal pride, isn't it, at the end of the day? Everyone wants to go out on a high.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly what Spain will be wanting to do here.
So Spain will just see out the remainder of this end. Belgium have played all of their six balls. As you can see, nicely packed around the Spain shot. Spain still holding. They'll do well to add another one here. So they will be attacking it, Spain.
Yeah, you know, they'll be wanting to end this
game.
Are
they looking to roll up the Belgian balls and sit on top, or?
Yeah, you know, that's an option. That's not too bad. You know, that can be used.
But they've got a good back position here, haven't they? If they can move the jack back. But
yeah. If
it's, know, a, it's a two or three ball plant, isn't it?
Yeah,
to move it, you need quite a lot of
hitting that red. They need to hit that the ball that's touching on it, square on, and move it by. Is that red's in a nice position now to be moved.
So I'm out. Zajal. Again, being very positive. All the extensions available. The ball right at the top of the ramp.
Yeah, they're just looking to go in with power here again.
And again, a little bit unlucky again.
Rolling back over the top of it. Again, that shot is still open for them to knock that white back.
Well, if you're going to finish on a bang, and there is an opportunity for Spain here. Nothing Belgium can do about it. If you're going to lose 7-6, it looks a little bit more respectable, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. You know, even 7-5, 7-4 is a bit more respectable than 7-0. You know, Spain will be disappointed that they never, you know, played like this in their previous ends, you know, leaving it to the last minute. You know, and again, that's the pressure element of the sport. You know, they got off to a rocky start, and Belgium capitalised on that.
Well, it was the four that was the damage, wasn't it, on the
yeah,
second end?
You know, Spain were chasing it from there on the third end. You know, they just couldn't get control quick enough. You know, they changed things up. For me, I thought they should have changed jack position. You know, they played in the short end. You know, I think that they had to go a little bit longer.
So again, with maximum power, Spain looking for the plant of their own ball onto the jack. Just rolled off the top again.
Yeah, just rolled over. Looks like it could be one.
I think it's one to Spain. The referee just going to come and confirm this. And it has been conceded. And it's one to Spain. But Belgium take the gold medal in this BC3 pairs match. They are the European champions and they have beaten Spain by 7-1. And Jamie Duckerty, quite a convincing victory for Belgium.
Yeah, the main difference is how they capitalised on those opportunities that they've been given. Spain came out and they were a bit nervy at the start, and that's at the end cost them the game.
And as well as the gold medal, Belgium have guaranteed their spot in Rio for the Paralympics in 2016.
Yeah, that's so important for them now, to build on from that, and that will give Belgium more confidence now as well.
Well, many congratulations to Belgium. A fine performance, and they will be seen in future competitions and at Rio.